Are you tired of paying too much in taxes? Here's how you can reduce your tax liability by 30% or more of your total solar installation costs. So Dale, a lot has changed in terms of the ITC, the investment tax credit, for residential and commercial entities. Why don't we take a dive in and start, let's talk about, first of all, the residential tax credit and what that looks like right now.
Sure. So it's richer than it had been.
Yeah.
So we're back to 30%. We've been there for years, and then it had gradually come down. But we're back to 30% through 2032. So it's a nice long span of increased tax credits for residential customers. The tax credit for residential is under Section 25. And under commercial, Section 48, and the rules are very different. And one of the things we've seen with the IRA bill that was passed was that changing even more drastically.
Right.
I mean, for years and years, it seemed like they were kind of viewed as the same thing, even though they never were. But they functioned pretty much the same way. And now we're seeing that change.
Correct. And so one of the things you can't do with the residential is you can't sell the solar tax credit like you can in the commercial.
Correct. Correct. Yeah, there's a number of things worn around the commercial. There are add-ons for different things, energy communities, low income,
yep.
Domestic content. None of that applies to residential. I actually had a call about that the other day from one of our consultants asking about the transferability of residential. And I said, no, that's not going to work.
Yep.
So the residential is pretty much functional the same way as it was because Section 25 was not really addressed very much in the IRA except to move it to 30%.
So let's talk about the ability to use the tax credit in the current year if you have the liability, and then the possibility of carrying it forward. I know you can't go backwards, but
yep.
If you could give some details on carrying it forward.
Yeah, and even here we have differences between residential and commercial.
Right.
So with residential, you can roll it forward to the following year if you can't use it. Under both of these, you have to owe the tax to take advantage of the credit.
Right.
So, under residential, you can roll it forward to the next year. If you can't use it all this year, you can roll it forward. That's fine. You cannot roll it backward.
Okay. Yep.
With the commercial, you can roll it backwards 3 years, and you can roll it forward for up to 22 years. So you've got a much longer span. Residential, as far as how far you can roll it forward, it's not really defined, and it's not been defined for years, even before the IRA bill. There was confusion around that. But certainly as long as the tax credit is in place, at least through 2032, you'd be able to use it.
Okay. So just in summary, for the residential component, the tax credit is 30%. It's good
right.
through 2032. And if you can't use it all of the tax credit in the first year, you can carry it forward up until 2032 is our understanding as of right
at
now.
At least. Yep.
At least.
Mm-hmm.
So now let's talk about specifically commercial and ag projects and what that looks like. And I know thanks to the IRA bill, there are more requirements for larger projects that really are at 1 megawatt AC or larger, which are very large projects, very little of what we do. And then there are different guidelines for projects that are under 1 megawatt AC.
Correct.
Can you talk about those differences?
Yeah, so the biggest difference between the two is that if you go over a megawatt on the AC side, you're going to be required to get the 30% base tax credit.
Right.
You're going to be required to have pay prevailing wage
okay.
for that area.
Right.
And you're going to have an apprenticeship program in place. And to be really honest, a lot of solar companies did not have that in place. So that's a challenge for companies like ourselves and others right now is to develop that apprenticeship program. Under a megawatt, none of that's required.
Yep.
So that's the biggest difference between over and under a megawatt.
Right. And we talked about in the residential section with the commercial tax credit that's currently at 30% as the base credit. You can go back 3 years now. It used to be 2 years. You can now go back 3 years and you can carry it forward for 22 years.
Right.
That's just for the base tax credit. Now there are additional adders thanks to the IRA. Talk about each one of those briefly.
Yeah, so there's varying amounts of detail that we know.
Yeah.
So let's start with the low-income community adder. That's 10%.
Right.
So if you're in that area, a designated area that meets that requirement, you can go through an application process, and it's actually twofold. You have to apply with the EPA, and you have to apply with the IRS.
Right.
And you're going to get scored. At the first step with EPA, you get scored on whether, how's that going to rank, you
right.
know, against other projects. Because there's a limit to how much they're going to award here. And it's based on the size, not on the dollars. So it's 1.8 gigawatts that's going to be available under the low income category.
So in that first part of the process, the EPA is making a recommendation to the IRS on whether or not to actually approve it. And it's up to the IRS. Just because you got approved in part one, you may not get actually approved.
Yeah, because what's going to happen is it's going to be oversubscribed probably.
Yeah.
So they're going to have more than 1.8 gigawatts and they're going to have this scoring system and they're going to know, you know, how many people applied and does your score get you anywhere close? And they're going to give you that recommendation.
All right. So that's for the first 10% adder. Now let's talk about the energy communities.
Mm-hmm. Energy community is a little bit simpler.
Yeah.
They've already published a map. You can go online and find that map. And there's basically, it's based on census tract. So if you had a coal mine that closed or a fossil fuel plant that closed, I think it's around 2000 or 1999, something like that. If it closed since then that census tract qualifies. And any census tract that's touching it is also qualifying. And then they have what they call the MSAs, which is something that's going to be adjusted each year. And that's a little metropolitan statistical area, I think it's called. And those areas, depending on some employment statistics and things that they track, will determine whether those census tracts qualify as well. But there's significant areas that are qualifying, particularly in some of our market area here at Paradise, Western PA, Eastern Ohio, all of West Virginia, and a band across Northern PA as well. Significant areas
right.
qualify.
And you can qualify for more than one 10% adder. You can qualify for the low income mm-hmm. as well as the energy communities
yes.
and potentially the domestic and so on and so forth. So you could stack these up.
Right.
So if you're interested in learning more about the or whether or not finding out you that whether or not you're in an energy community, the map is on the IRS's website?
It is.
Okay, great. So now let's talk about the domestic content adder.
Yes. Okay. This one's an interesting one. A lot of uncertainty around this one. It's split structural steel and iron and manufactured products on systems. So let's say you did a ground mount. The posts would be structural steel, and that has to be 100% U.S. made
right.
to qualify for this. And then any manufactured products, it has to be 40% U.S. made.
Right.
And that gets really tricky. The whole calculation, I think that's a whole separate video, and I think we've done one on. But that whole calculation around how you arrive at that 40% is really messy, and it's going to require a lot of information for people like ourselves, like Paradise, to receive from the manufacturers to say, here's the components in our inverter or in our modules, and what components are U.S. made and what percentage of the cost of that product is it?
Correct. So we're waiting on really the manufacturers at this point to be able to attest to the fact that X amount of their components are made in the United States.
Correct.
And whether or not it actually qualifies for it.
Right.
So those are the three adders, the 10% for the low energy areas, 10% for the 10% for the low income, 10% for the energy communities, and 10% for the domestic content. What about for nonprofits?
Nonprofits are in a new position. They used to have to use power purchase agreements for the most part or some type
right.
of lease arrangement. And now they qualify for direct pay. They also use the word elective pay. But basically, a non-taxpaying entity, municipalities, nonprofits, can now qualify to receive a refund, to receive payment for the ITC,
right.
for the tax credit. And that would include any adders. So if they were to qualify for, you know, an energy community and nothing else, and they had the tax credit, they would qualify for 40%. And that money would be paid to the entity.
But the requirements for that are changing over the next few years. So currently in 2023, you don't have to worry about the domestic content or any other requirements.
Right.
What's happening starting next year?
Well, next year they're going to start to bring in the domestic content piece into it. So 2023 is the best year to do this, actually. So 2024, you have to have domestic content on the product. You have to meet those requirements, the same as everybody else. Or if you don't, you only get 90% of your tax credit.
Right.
The following year, it's 85%, 2025. And the following year, 2026, it's zero.
Right.
So it will not be refunded to these nonprofits after 1/1/26 if they're not meeting the domestic content requirement.
Great. And then we created a video on this as well, the transferability, which is new,
right?
The ability to sell or transfer the tax credit. Mm-hmm. Really briefly sum that up for us.
Yeah, so basically what it does is allows people who can't use that tax piece, that this tax credit, which is not refundable, what they can do is sell it. And there's going to have to be brokerages, there's got to be platforms that develop to enable you to do this, and there's more guidance needed as to the exact how it will work, the details around that. But what we know is you're going to have to register your system, and then you'll be able to sell your tax credit to somebody else who wants that tax credit.
Right. And then there's multiple parts to the investment tax credit. One of them, well, there's the investment tax credit to the Section 48. There's the investment tax credit. There's a production tax credit.
Right.
How do they compare? What's the difference between those?
Yeah, those are the two that apply to solar. Yeah. There's other tax credits in Section 48 that do not apply to solar. But the PTC, production tax credit, is different in that it is paid on the output of the system. So, and it's a per kilowatt hour number. And that number can be adjusted for inflation or as the IRS sees fit. But you can take that. If you don't take the investment tax credit, you can take the production tax credit for 10 years on the system. Where we see this being most functional, Warren, and I've looked at numbers on this, usually for our clients that Paradise works with, the non-utility scale market, it's ITC.
Yeah.
That's what makes sense. You get into some of the really big utility scale where you've got possibly real high outputs in certain regions of the country, and some real low costs because of the scope, the sheer size of the project, then the PTC may make more sense. And in addition, whoever owns that system in that year can take the tax credit. So you don't have to take it all.
Yeah.
You know, if I'm part of ownership for 3 years, I get 3 years worth of the PTC, and then the next owner gets the next 7 years if they hold it that long.
All right, Dale, so it seems like there's a lot of clarity that's missing on these different pieces. When do you think we'll have more guidance on this?
Yeah, I think we're going to be staring at third and fourth quarter guidance coming out. I think hopefully by the end of the year, we'll have most of it. Energy community is pretty clear. They've got the map, so I think we're pretty clear on that. You just file it with your tax return. The other ones, low-income community, we need the process to be defined more tightly. Domestic content, we need manufacturers to provide information as to what's going to get us there. And as far as transferability and the direct pay, there's still some details needed around that. So, the IRS has a lot of work ahead of it.
Yeah. So in summary, with the commercial projects, there's quite a bit that's changed and some new guidance coming out that impacts whether or not you're going to get some of the or how all the adders will work. There's also additional requirements if your project is over 1 megawatt AC. Very large projects will be required to pay prevailing wage as well as have apprenticeship programs. So know that we don't have complete clarity on any of the adders yet. Hopefully we will by the end of the year. And when it comes to the solar tax credit, the investment tax credit for businesses, remember you can roll back and go back 3 years, use it in the current year, roll back 3 years, and then carry it forward for 22 years. For the most part, the investment tax credit seems to make more sense than the production tax credit for smaller systems. And then finally, if you're a nonprofit or a municipality, you now have the ability to get a direct payment from the Treasury Department or the IRS, as opposed to not being able to take the tax credit as well. Thank you so much for watching. We hope you found this valuable. Please leave a comment in the comment section below if you like this video. Even if you didn't like the video, leave a comment, but let us know why. And thanks for watching.